Ladies and gentlemen, let me warmly welcome you in Prague at the Czech Technical University and online participants on Zoom. Our ICPRS 5-7 working group has in mind mission of connecting science branches, professionals and specialists, young scientists across the professional orientation of geomatic, construction, architecture. The issue of DIM is a typical multidisciplinary solution which combines the activities of various professions for a comprehensive settlement of the final process. Such are goals of our conference as well, to seek new knowledge in multidisciplinary discussion. Let me invite Professor Pacák Bořek, Vice Dean for Science and Research, for another speech.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear distinguished guests, let me welcome you at the Faculty of Civil Engineering of the Czech Technical University in Prague on behalf of our Dean, Professor Jiří Máca. Digitalization of industry is one of the key strategic activity that should bring in the revolution in management, maintenance and production. And it's particularly very much needed in traditional fields such as civil engineering. And therefore, it's very nice to see, increasing adoption of technologies such as the building information management, augmented or virtual reality, GPS, laser scanning, photogrammetry, or remote sensing. And I particularly find very interesting the topic of creating the digital twin of the existing, often historical infrastructure that we have here, particularly in this country, and for which we have to establish these digital twins for further efficient maintenance. So with that, I am very happy that the faculty can participate in organizing this event that can somehow contribute to development in this area. And with that, I would like to wish you a very fruitful conference with interesting talks and motivating discussions. And I hope that you will enjoy, a nice environment here at the faculty, at least for those who are physically present, and that also you will have a time to enjoy the beautiful city of Prague. So thank you for coming, thank you for participating, and have a nice day.
So dear colleagues, on behalf of our working group, we welcome you from far and snowy Siberia. For those who don't know, he is from Russian Federation, and he's from Novosibirsk. That is why it's from far and snowy Siberia. So we would like to submit our special greetings to all participants of ICPRS Working Group Workshop. Wish you success and new achievements, new meetings and new ideas. We wish you good health and hope that the restrictions associated with the pandemic will be removed soon. I would like to express my immense gratitude to my friends from Prague for the significant work done in organizing the conference. See you next time. We'll always be with you. With kind regards from Siberia, Professor Vladimir Seredovich. And now it's turn for another guest, special guest, who's also didn't come but sent us video. Congratulations, I mean General Secretary of the ICPRS, Professor Lena Holunova. So please start the video.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me welcome you here in Prague at the second workshop organized by a working group of the International Society for Photogrammetry and Remote Sensing. The workshop is called Measurement, Visualization and Processing in BIM for Design and Construction Management. The title itself shows us how the idea of the organizers, and I would like to thank them very much, is to combine technical science of civil engineering and their development and geospatial societies and their science. And it's a very important step in the development, because many tools which have been developed in geospatial sciences will allow now engineers to work efficiently and to create a completely new way how to handle with buildings, with constructions and so on. So my message becomes very just appreciating the activity, and it comes from the International Society for Photogrammetry and Remote Sensing. The society itself is represented by council, and I, as a member of council, would like to highlight the activity which was appreciated by the ISPRS as well, not only by organizing or helping to organize this workshop, but also to invite organizers of this workshop to prepare a forum which will take place during the ISPRS Congress in June this year. It will be between the 6th and 11th of June in Nice in France. And I believe that the results of this workshop will encourage you to take part in forum and share your experiences, not only from here, but from your life dedicated to this branch, with other participants, which we even now do not know who will be in Nice. But it's a very, very important topic. And I wish you to enjoy the meeting, to enjoy Prague, and also social side of meetings, which all of us appreciate quite a lot, I believe. So this is my message. My name is Lena Halounová, and Lena is inviting you sincerely to Nice. Good luck in your meeting here. Good luck in your life.
As you saw, everything is going around the working group 5-7, our working group, and we decided to how to start the presentation. And we decided to show you the, to demonstrate you the activity of our working group and maybe familiarize you with some features. And of course, we would like to present probably the future of our working group. So, here we go.
The topic of this short presentation is BGG 7 prospective activities and challenges. This presentation deals with mission of our working group. Pathways and goals, terms of reference of our working group, those who are from the ISPRS structure, they know what it is. Well, the events, schedule of our working group, the events that we already organized and the events that we hope to organize in the future. And some suggestions according to the name or title of our working group, because this working group will be established during the ISPRS Congress in June this year.
And that's why it's important to slightly rearrange the name of our working group. And I'll explain later why it's important, not only for us, but for you too. So, the working group was established in 2016 during the Congress, aims to promote global literacy and advance of innovations in geospatial technologies, architects, civil engineers. And also designers, through the development of multidisciplinary cutting-edge education, that facilitates knowledge exchange between various science organizations that are involved. So you see the main goal of the group is building the bridge between surveyors, Orographers, GIS analysts, and architects, civil engineers, maybe environmental engineers, whatever, from the other hand. Well, that's clear because group works with civil engineers and architects, so the BIM is the key topic of our working group. But this group is about education, and that's why working group also shares educational content, develops new novel electronic components of training education in our brain, remote sensing, surveying, and so on. For architects, civil engineers, etc. And you understand that today, according to the event that you all familiar with, I mean pandemic outbreak, the e-learning component probably one of the main component today. So the target audience, I already said about that, civil engineers, architects, surveyors, and so on. And how do we approach the ideas of our working group? We are considering maybe the tools how to approach our ideas using four main components: traditional learning, web-facilitated learning, blended and hybrid learning, and e-learning or online education. You know what is it, traditional learning? We all are from the university or from the research structures, and we know what is it, traditional learning. And for our working group, it works good in the case of summer winter school organization or some seminars and so on. That facilitated learning is maybe more convenient today because it's combination of traditional learning with internet. And another case is the blended or hybrid learning, where all components are done online and there is a little face-to-face interaction between teacher and student, let's say. We realized that it isn't possible to achieve our goals just using one of these options. And that is why during the work of our group, we combined different of these methods. We organized different workshops, we organized seminars, we organized trainings. Some of them were totally online, some of them were blended or hybrid learning. and so on. Just for the maybe for some for information, you see here the information. By the way, I've taken this from the website before pandemic outbreak. It was in 2019, and even here you may see that for the United States and the enrollment, the students' enrollment using online education is growing up, and you see that even for that time it was over 20 million students that taken their courses totally online. And also another one very important statistics, not important, rather interesting, yeah. You see different percents how distributed the volume of online involved students in educational process. What's interesting, let's say, that you see even before pandemic, almost half of the students fall between the age of 19 and 30 years. It means that our target audience is mostly based on the young people, by the way. Well, if we consider top 10 most popular online degrees or online courses, we may notice that among these 10, there are three that are definitely concerning the activity of our working group. So, computer science, IT technology, and graphic design. And that's clear because for the Grimitri today, it is computer science, it is graphic design, it is IT technologies. Well, among the themes of, I'll move forward to the pathways and goals of our working group. And among the themes that we propose, and on the other hand, that already were disseminated, you see a lot of BIM different courses, a BIM for civil engineers, for architects, of course, from our point of view, not the BIM from the point of view of civil engineer, rather the BIM from the point of surveyor or photogrammetries. Various courses concerning programming languages, especially R programming language, also MATLAB, and so on. And also various teams that are about various remote sensing applications for, let's say, environmental engineering, culture heritage presentation, and so on. Well, here are the terms of reference of our working group. I'm not going to read out all of this. You may see this on the iSPRS website, but here are some little changes. But anyway, in general, you may see the directions of our working group. And the events, the schedule of events, the main for today is the organization of the round table education towards digital transformation in Nice. You heard Lena also mentioned Nice today during his congratulation. And this round table also will combine the topics of our working group, but we're going to consider the problems of education probably in detail, or probably from the more global point of view. So you see, for example, should the digital education approach be different, for example, for civil engineering and mathematicians, or for surveyors and for architects? Well, the difference between traditional and digital education significant regarding quality or effectiveness? Or, very interesting, should we still commit to the current timelines for education in the case of its digital form? That's the question. Yeah? So, we're going to discuss all of these questions during our roundtable in Nice. And we are encouraging you to take part if some of you are interested in those activities that I've already mentioned. So please stop by me or Carl and share your ideas. We're open. If some of you will attend Congress in Nice, we welcome you to our round table. Well, also, here are the top questions, and now the topics of the round table. You see, here is everything from geospatial technologies in multidisciplinary training up to digital twins, smart cities, virtual reality technologies, and so on. In the context, of course, in the context of education. Something interesting, according to the events that our group is already has organized during the last three years, because you know the last year was totally blocked out. So during the 3 years, we organized 6 events. We're extending our geography. You see, it were in Germany, in Prague, in Nepal, in India, and so on. And for the next 2 years, we're going to organize 2 additional events, one in Kazakhstan, and I hope another one will be in Lithuania, probably. Well, mentioned this. Well, also our working group will take part in the promotion of activity through the system of getting grants for educational programs. The universities involved. We are going to issue the edition of online tutorial innovative geospatial technologies for multidisciplinary applications and much more. And the final question is the name of our working group. You see, the name was very long, innovative photogrammetry and remote sensing technologies in blah, 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 communication and knowledge exchange. Well, currently, our working group has name innovative technologies in training civil engineers and architects, and we are going to modify its name to AEC, Education Towards Digital Transformation. But also, any suggestions or maybe any remarks are welcome. Well, that's it. I got carried away slightly, but I guess that's nothing. Well, thank you. So I guess the agenda for the opening ceremony is used up. hasn't come. That's why I'll make the joint presentation, the first one and the second one will be together. I see that all the participants for the section one are here, and Professor Jager, he's not here, but he will join us through the Zoom. Well, and since we have 2 hours, we are not going to keep the schedule minute to minute, of course, but please don't hold out your presentations and don't overuse your time. Well, since the first presentation is mine, I'll introduce myself. My name is Roman Schulz. I'm from Ukraine. Currently, I'm a researcher in the Research Institute of Geodesy, Topography, and Cartography, Czech Republic. And my presentation is about the capabilities of 3D geospatial technologies in the decision support process for design, construction, and employment of engineering structures. You see, the title in general contains the thing that generally called as building life cycle. You know? Well, today I'm going to discuss with you, of course you are familiar, what is it? 3D geospatial technologies, but I just want to emphasize some features of 3D geospatial technologies today. And then we will proceed to the design stage, and we'll see how 3D geospatial technologies work for design stage, then for construction, for the exploitation. Then I'm going to present you the concept of complete control. That's something new. And finally, we'll have some conclusions. All of these steps are supported with very interesting hands-on material. Very interesting practical examples. Most of them, by the way, are God thanks to the works of Vladimir Seridovich, first of all. So, digital construction. Probably, you realize that everything today is digital, yeah? So we speak about digital education, we speak about digital economy, we speak about digital photography, whatever, yeah? Well, and why we shouldn't use the term digital construction? So digital construction today is a part of the digital economy and the digitalization of all cutting-edge processes worldwide. And the methods of digital construction make possible to fully implement BIM and provide complete control of geometric parameters of the construction and operation of engineering structures. In recent years, 3D geospatial technologies, these technologies have taken the prominent, the leading role in civil engineering. And that's why surveyors, surveyors, photogrammetries, GIS specialized also, have exerted more efforts in order to study the possibilities of these technologies. But All of these studies are about special features that are important for us. What I mean? I mean that what's important for us? We speak about accuracy, we speak about reliability, we speak about how to calibrate some equipment and so on and so on. But it's, do you think it's interesting for civil engineer? I guess no. For them, the main point of 3D geospatial technologies is how to implement these technologies into construction process. So, thanks to developments of recent years, we have a lot of achievements for 3D geospatial technologies. They are listed here, but just let's say you see effective preliminary processing of measurements or fusion of measuring equipment and means of data processing and so on. And among everything, among different technologies like GNSS, total station, and so on, the terrestrial laser scanning takes advanced part in this technology. That's why everything on the rest in this presentation will be mostly about terrestrial laser scanning and how terrestrial laser scanning helps to integrate their data into construction process, into BIM, and helps our civil engineers to make right decisions, decision support process. You all know this picture, it's very famous, yeah, that well-known diagram of building life cycle. And if we overlay the BIM over this picture, we see that BIM takes part in each step of the building life cycle, during design, during building, during operation, and even during the building demolition. Well, and of course, we may overlay the third layer over BIM, the layer of geospatial technologies. Well, now, so the issue, I already declared it, civil engineers and architects cannot comprehend, I wouldn't say, of course, comprehend, it's very, maybe cannot realize deeply the role of 3D geospatial technologies in their task, especially for such a modern concept as BIM. And the goal of this presentation is twofold. So the first goal is to shed light on the liaison, the connection between 3D technologies and the decision support process in civil engineering. And the second aim is to present the complete control concept, mostly based on the terrestrial laser scanning. Why terrestrial laser scanning is so attractive for civil engineers? Here are some features or some benefits of. Of course, they are not maybe not so attractive for us, for surveyors, not for us, for surveyors, for photogrammetrists. Let's say the first one, data are similar to the picture, but with 3D metric. Yeah, for us it's clear. Yeah, but. For architects or civil engineers, it looks very, very attractive. Or another way, you see measurement results have unique properties like reliability, the well-known principle, what you see is what you get, completeness, continuity, transparency, the possibility of automating processing and transfer via the internet, let's say, sufficient accuracy, and so on. And thanks to these features, TLS data have built a bridge between outdated design and construction technology in civil engineering and state-of-the-art approaches that are inseparable part of BIM. And let's get down to the real application of 3D geospatial technologies and GIS, TLS particularly. As I already mentioned, the first step or stage, better say stage, of building life cycle is design stage. Sometimes this stage also includes redesign or reconstruction. And here is the good example, the reconstruction of the highway roundabout. The process of reconstruction included geodetic network creation, scanning the roadway and curbs, data processing and data preparation for designers. And the final product have a form of BIM. What does it mean? It means that except for the geometrical information, this model also had semantic information. And of course, some topology between object also has been created. The main conclusion is that thanks to the application of terrestrial lidar scanning, the project cost was reduced up to 12%. Not project in total, I mean the step of the design stage. The cost of design stage was reduced. So no paper maps, no discrete measurements. The total picture of 3D, the total 3D model of the structure, that helped to facilitate the design process. Sometimes it is more important to support the design stage with, let's say, just using 3D point cloud, like here. So architects or civil engineers already, let's suppose, already have some 3D model in form of in some of BIM formats, and the task is to embed this 3D model into real situation. That's why you may use 3D point cloud, integrate this point cloud with BIM, and the designers see the real situation and how their design construction fits to the real environment. One more interesting case is the reconstruction of building facades. Everyone knows that after construction, the surface of facade almost never smooth. Yeah, and in order to cover this facade or decorate this facade, the customer has to manufacture some plates and cover these plates, cover the facade with these plates. So here the example, you see the results of 3D scanning of building facade. You see here, so it's right. the facade deviates from the plane. It's very clear. And thanks to the TLS data, the panel sizes data were transmitted to the plant, where they were cut and adjusted to the actual sizes. And this study has shown that the plant saved up to 10% of time and materials during the production of this hinged panel to cover the facade. You see, left side is the design from BIM, right side is the real situation, and the fusion of these 3D models gave an opportunity to adjust the panel's sizes and save time and save material. One more case in the reconstruction. This is from Seredovich. Here's the airport, Almachova. I know it from Novosibirsk. And the reconstruction of this airport. Well, the next stage is the construction. And here we may see the case when the typical building, it's not high-rise building, but considerably smaller, of course, than high-rise building. But anyway, so the scanning of the building outside was accomplished. And then the same scanning was done for the interior. Yeah? So the building was scanned from the inside. And finally, these results were integrated into BIM at the design stage. So you see the background is from the design stage. And the real complex with some engineering infrastructure and how this complex fits with the design model, we may see. But not only this, thanks to the 3D point cloud, we may generate the geometry of the interiors. We may control the sizes of some geometric features, geometric characteristics, and even control, but I'm getting ahead of myself. That's the question, the last question will be. Well, so we may get the geometry, and even we may get the information for the maybe some design and reconstruction. One more case, it's again the large sport complex in Novosibirsk, and for those who were in Novosibirsk, they know that I guess in January minus 20 or 30 degrees is the normal temperature. Well, and when we considered the features of the modern 3D technologies, you saw one of them was the large temperature range for the operation of modern equipment. And that's the case when Rigel 3D scanner can operate under such adverse conditions, I would say. Well, and the output of this scanning and of this application of 3D technologies, you see 3D models, but not only 3D models. We have, like here, the truss and the full geometry of the truss with deviations, again, from the design project. One more case, also another part of this structure, and again, the chart with displacements, or better to say, deviations of the project and design. And the third last step is the step of exploitation. It's better to demonstrate the benefits of 3D geospatial technologies at the stage of exploitation for the roads, for the highways. We're all drivers, so we know what is it, pitholes or bumps on the road. So the example is about determination of the size and position of bumps and potholes on the highway, and the reconstruction of the road, and the left one picture demonstrates the situation when the upper part, it's already reconstructed highway, and bottom part is before the reconstruction. And you may see, even in contours, you may see the difference. Yeah. Well, also we may determine, of course, the position of some problem places on the highway using 3D point cloud, and much more. You know, it's not enough only that your road is smooth, but it's very important to know the thickness of your layer on the highway. And for this situation, again, TLS data helps us to do this, and we may determine thickness and the volume of material that was spent for the reconstruction. And you see that's economy question again. And finally, we've got the 3D model, again, in BIM format. This model looks like design model, but I want to pay your attention that this model also contains the deviations from the project. So analyze and may study the results of the reconstruction. And the second part of the any structure exploitation is monitoring. Many people, many scientists familiar with this well-known workflow of geospatial monitoring. Design and three steps, preparation, measurements, and analysis. Yeah? And now let's see how this scheme or this workflow may be changed thanks to the application of BIM. So if we... we already saw the green one cycle, it's a building life cycle. We also saw the yellow one cycle, it is about BIM. But if we add the geospatial monitoring, we will see that geospatial monitoring covers or embraces the main steps of the building life cycle. I mean, construction, operation, renovation, and even building demolition. And thanks to this, the new scheme of geospatial monitoring, it's just a suggestion, it's not the rule, of course, may look like this. BIM at the left top of this scheme. BIM, it's not visible here, but over the monitoring design, there is also one more arrow that follows the requirements. So BIM generates the requirements for the geospatial monitoring design. Then we may use BIM as a virtual environment for the measurements design at the step of the preparation. We may use project BIM model for the comparison of our results with the design model. And of course, any BIM contains calculation model, Today, it is mostly FEM model, so finite element model. And thanks to this, we may construct more advanced and more precise models for the prediction of displacements of the structure. And in real life, it looks like this. So we have a 3D model of the building. We may use 3D environment for the geospatial monitoring design. Then we have construction model that can be used for the comparison of our results. We have calculation model, this model in the form of the finite elements. And finally, by the results of the monitoring and the comparison with FEM model, we may get such an informative picture when we can analyze the displacements at every point of the structure. Well, and the final question is the question of complete control. That's probably something new. We understand the complete control as a tool that allows determining the parameters of all structure elements without random sampling that it was before. How it was before, some of you probably knows that surveyors have to set up his equipment, measure some points, but of course, no one surveyor can measure all the points in the building, around the building, and so on. So typically, it was the control was the random sampling. So the surveyor or civil engineer assigned some points that are probably the most important as a, for, let's say, column. So the bottom and the up of the column, surveyor couldn't measure the column sizes along the some edges of the column and so on. And the concept of complete control has become possible just after the dissemination of geospatial technologies, 3D geospatial technologies in civil engineers and civil engineering. And thanks to this, civil engineers obtained a chance to control the structure as a whole, not by the sum structure, separate structure elements. Well, during the construction stage, the complete control may be realized during the fusion of design data in BIM with TLS data in real time. During the discrepancies determination between the project and the actual geometry of the structure elements, during the making the structural element that do not meet the marking the structural element that do not meet the requirements. Then for the engineering infrastructure scanning and comparing with the project, and for the surrounding territory scanning and comparing with the project. During the exploitation stage, we may apply complete control for structure scanning at the stage of operation, monitoring the structure, determination of deviations from the project, and so on. Then, for quality assurance check, working out a project to repair and reconstruct the structure. And during the last step of the building demolition stage, we may apply complete control for the structure disassembling and bringing the surrounding territory to the design stage. And for territory scanning, documentation of the final results. And let's see how it works on practice. We have a building, a very typical building, at the stage of construction. We have the point cloud of this building. Now, thanks to the this point cloud is not empty. So you understand this point cloud contains information from outside and inside both. And we may determine the deviations of the walls from the project. Each wall with a discrete with step, let's say 5 by 5 millimeters or 10 by 10 millimeters. But any wall, any geometric parameters. So the deviations of the floor from the project and discrepancies between the real ceiling, yeah, and the ceiling from design. Much more, we can construct cross sections at any floor with any step. We can control column displacements. Each column for such a building, I don't remember exactly, but it is more than 600 columns. You realize that no surveyor is that can measure such a large, vast volume of columns or make such a large volume of measurements and control the plate thickness deviations for each place, for plate, for each floor. Well, that's it. I'm finishing with some conclusions, but they're clear. I guess we already discussed the digital construction. We know it's important. We know that the role of, already know that the role of 3D geospatial technologies is very important. We know that surveying techniques today provide the increased objectivity, reliability, accuracy, and so on. And thanks to the last one, probably, is the most important, that thanks to 3D data, the building life cycle can become open and accessible to investors, developers, customers, and buyers. So the application of digital technologies in the construction industry, and not only in the construction, can lead to the revolutionary changes. The construction industry is becoming transparent in space and time, accessible and open. That's it, but not it for, that's it for presentation, but future studies will have to continue exploring the capabilities of 3D geospatial technologies in decision support process and especially their integration into BIM. Now that's it. Thanks for your attention.
Yeah, should I speak? Yeah, now I can. Hello, everyone on the internet. Good. I'm talking about BIM and GIS integration from the standardization perspective. But first, I will give a short lecture on the topic. When we talk about integration to have a layered concept in our mind, we start with the application. That's the top level. Then the information model or the data, and I will give an example. Maybe you think that the most common principle of integration is when both the application and the information model use the same functions and the same data. And this would be, for example, the case for indoor navigation. You have a building digital building model, and or the city GMN model, and then you use the same functionality with the same data. But there are just a few use cases really with this precise focus. More common is that one domain has a functionality but does not fulfill the functionality of the other domain. Can I get the presenter maybe if it's ready to put the pointer? Yes. But it, you, here you see the error. The functionality depends on the information from the other domain. And I will give you some examples later. Yeah, okay. Yeah. And also I will show you that this is a very important use case. And I will give examples. But the most common use case is that neither BIM or GIS is the main leading software or the application, but some other things like building permits or environmental audits, and they just take the data from the geospatial world or the building models, and they don't care, the functionality does not care where it comes from, it just has to use it. And I will show you examples on this. One example is our that we developed at our university, Autodesk Revit plugin. The use case is take the geodata you get and bring it to the BIM software. The BIM authoring tool. Sorry, you are not my students, but could you be please quiet? I know, it's really, you know, as a teacher, you get like this. So we take the geodata and bring it to the BIM authoring tool. Knowing that the BIM authoring tool, Autodesk Revit, is not really good with geodata. But however, the functionality is needed by the planners. And for example, we developed a tool for georeferencing, integrating digital terrain model, city model, cadastre, some CAD to BIM functionality, and a specialized customized IC export. And Dr. Kaiser here, please sign up. He's the main developer of this software. And it's used by the German railway, for example. And it's open source, and you can download it at GitHub. So this is one example. Another example is also very simple. So you have a 3D model of a building, and you want to bring to a map. A map is clearly geospatial topic. Cartography is, well, that's geospatial, of course. But you want to see the floor plans on the map, for example, in OpenStreetMap. So you take the BIM information and bring it to the geo world. Interesting topic and very clear use case. But most of the times when you go to the companies and look what they are doing actually with geospatial data and digital building models is they have their own problem. For example, infrastructure planning. And then we have in Dresden, where I'm from, a company, A plus S, very successful also in the Ukraine. They have an office. And they just take what they get and include it to their, let's say, common data environment. They take all the geodata, environmental data, the 3D models, the whatever, and integrate it. And they don't care if this is geospatial data or building data. They just have to solve their use cases. Okay, as you see, there are many, many different use cases. And we now have to think, how do standards support these use cases? What can we do? How can we do the world better from the standardization? And there was a working group, the Joint Working Group 15 for GIS and BIM integration from 2018 to 2021. A lot of meetings, collaborative text writing in place here in Beijing. This was a nice, really nice meeting. And the result was a technical report. So not a new standard, but a technical report, which suggests new work item proposals for BIM GIS interoperability. And we had some working groups, and I just named them so you get a picture what we talked about. So about domain expert communication, which is difficult, a joint principle of conceptual modeling, semantic interoperability, spatial referencing, geometric representation, process definitions, product handling. These were the subgroups, and you see the topics are very broad. And I now want to show you what is the scope of the technical report. So I'm here to promote this ISO technical report that you will buy it for 80, Franken from Switzerland. So it's quite expensive, or you read the paper in the proceedings, my paper, and then you get the most information. Okay, and I want to show you what are the categories to describe BIM-GIS interoperability. What are the barriers and opportunities of BIM-GIS integration? And what is the real result of the suggestions for new work icon proposals? Okay, this is the content of the report. How many pages? Like 60 or I think some more, 70 pages. So when you read this, you will get a compendium of all BIM and GIS standards. So if you're looking for standards, you have them all listed and how they are related to each other. Then the results of the sub-working groups, what are the barriers and opportunities for integration, and then the result, suggestions for further standardization work, and some extra information in the annex about georeferencing, for example. Okay, the scope of this technical report may be described here in this figure. So we have our profession. I'm an engineering surveyor, actually. We have GIS expert on knowing how to deal with geodata. And then we have the BIM world, design, construction, operate, and they all share the information, but still there is a barrier. Because the architecture, engineering, construction, operation, and owner world. So this acronym gets longer and longer. Architect, engineer, construction, operation, and owning. And geospatial domain have been seen as different domains traditionally. But as we already have learned in your presentation before, this is not the modern way of thinking. But on the standardization level, the BIM community is currently developing standards, defining terms, processes, business models maybe, but not so much technical things, where the GIS or geospatial community has really a very good set of very good modularized standards. If you take the ISO 19XXX series, it's very well structured, it's very functional, very technical, it focuses on the software development, but this is not in the BIM world. So in conclusion, the standards from BIM and GIS at ISO level cannot be mapped one-to-one because they have a totally different scope. And that was, we started the working group by saying we want to map the standards, and then we recognize this is not possible. So it's more getting to know each other. Yeah. And this working group I'm presenting here is at ISO level. And you should know, and I guess you know, that ISO is really not the major driving force in the process. OGC and Building Smart are the driving forces for new standards, and ISO are just the one who make the final standard. However, this group was still interesting. Okay, and then a French professor came up with the idea in the working group to categorize the interoperability by a standard which is neither from geospatial world nor from the BIM world, but from, I don't know, businessman, okay? And you will see that there are some interoperability concerns. And these concerns relate to business, process, service, and data. And the barriers might be conceptual, technological, or organizational. And the interoperability approaches might be bring all the things in one model, an integrated model, bring it to a meta model and unify all the information or work with linked and federated data. So this is a very general approach. And we started with in our working group and tried to put the different problems and use cases here in this check thing, you know, your colors. But then we decided to focus only on the service and data level, because business is not so much a thing of standardization. So we really thought about data and services and more technological and conceptual barriers. So we didn't use the whole framework, but just the subset. Okay, and what are the barriers? I will not read out all the numbers. This is really boring when you're working on standardization. You have to remember all these many numbers, 19101, 19103, 19111. But we tried to map somehow in a model-driven architecture the standards. So we have the conceptual schema language, meta models, abstract concept schemas, application schemas, and implementation schemas. And we tried to find the same model-driven architecture in the BIM standards. Yeah, and it's not easy. You will see IFC in many levels. See this here, IFC, you don't have to know in detail, but the industry foundation class have a layered concept, and some the lower concept is utility classes, actually, then very abstract things like what is an object, what is an attribute, and then what is a building element, and then what is a wall or a column. And some things are easy to compare. So an IFC object is a GIS feature. That's the same concept, basically. And some geometric or topological concepts are very good comparable. I will show you later some things. But in the industry foundation classes, looking from the geo perspective, some things are really, really different. For example, the relationships in IFC are objectified. So if you have a relation between two objects, like a room, room belongs to this column, table in this room. This is a relationship, and this is an object itself in IFC. Where in GIS, we mostly use links to other objects. Then GIS does not have the concept of prototyping. So it just model one thing once and then place it several times in the scene. This is not so much used in GIS because there are many things for that. And the spatial structure, it's very different. So in a construction project and the digital representation of it, you have things like a building, a story, a room, and so. And in GIS, we more focus on the location, not so much on the structure. So there, with these three examples, I want to show you that the concepts are really different in modeling. Okay, this is you can read it later in my paper. Just to give you some ideas, we checked simple things like, what is a line in GIS and a line in IFC? Or what is a collection of solids in GML and in IFC? And how are these modeled? And we have a table in the report, quite long. Or the important concept of georeferencing. I remember your traffic crossroad, and I know from many projects in Germany, BIM projects, that this is a crucial part of the georeferencing at the very beginning of the project. So we as geospatial manager, we should be there at the very beginning and say, everyone, please name the project base point. What is north, really? What is project north? What is the height? And what scale are we using to bring the geospatial data to the 3D world? It's not easy. I will tell you. And it's not easy because the industry foundation classes, which is the major format for model exchange, is not clear in georeferencing. You can do it like this, or like this, or like this, or like this, and it's a valid model. So you have to say at the very beginning of the project, how does the georeferencing be represented in an IFC file? And at our university, we developed a concept, very simple concept. Is it just an address? Is it a point on the map? Is it actually not very good simple transformation to we have the concept of a coordinate reference system, and do we have additional metadata? And so we just name it 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, and we provide software to check it. This is important in BIM processes in general, that you have checking software. So because you have many people or engineers delivering data, and you need to check the data automatically. And we provide some tool for checking the georeferencing. Just an example. And another example, we have heard before that semantics are very important in BIM, maybe the leading way of thinking in building information modeling is the semantics, not so much the geometry. And the BIM community is currently developing a concept, property servers and data dictionaries. I don't know if you've heard of this. This is a concept, this is not common to the geospatial world. I call this X schema. So it's not defined in IC, not in GML, but it's outside of the schema, X schema, semantic alignment with dictionaries and property server. So Building Smart International, for example, is providing a server, the Building Smart Data Dictionary, which defines single terms. Each term gets a number, an English expression, and a Czech and a German expression. Okay, so this is the data dictionary. And then you can, for a project, set up a property server, and you say a wall or a column. A wall needs to have a nice picture, needs to have a good material, and properties on that, like 5 or 8 or 100 properties defining a wall. And this information is provided by the property server, who delivers property data templates, empty forms to describe an object. And then the manufacturers, those who are providing windows and doors and columns, fill in the information, fill in the values of the attribute, deliver product data sheets, filled in forms to the BIM project. And this, the BIM software and the, or maybe GIS software, is able to check if the attributes are all set, if they are in the range and everything. So this is a concept currently developing on standardization level for BIM. And my proposal was that the geospatial world is doing the same thing. We may don't like it. I have a contact with the German street authority, and they say, no, we don't want this. This is a new thing. So it's harder. But maybe it's good to say, okay, we use the same track here. Develop geo product data templates, where our manufacturer is not so much a company, but more the holy God, you know, because who creates the world, the trees and the terrain, maybe the streets. Okay, so these are not windows and doors, but other objects, topographic objects. And then the geospatial data provider or the land surveyor providing geo product data sheets, bring it to the BIM or GIS software, and it can be checked. And there is currently developing a whole framework of standards for the BIM world, and my idea is that the geo world is taking this. Okay. This is a boring slide. I would say I would recommend that you read the paper, and I listed all the opportunities, and I continue with the suggestions for further standardization work items. So we identified the barriers. We talked about what are the opportunities in our group. And then we identified the three major things. There are many things to do, but the three major things. The first thing is very academic. So it's something for you, okay? Most of you are academics, I guess. So we know that the abstract concepts in BIM and GIS are very different. And there are a lot of scientific publications how to link the abstract concepts using semantic web technology. We have a presentation tomorrow on this idea. Yes, but there's no standard for it. There are many approaches, many good ideas, very scientifically, but it's not in the industry. And the standards are not made for you, but for the industry. So this is a major task. And then a second thing is, and we will start with the second one in February 15th. So next week, we have the first meeting to write a dictionary for the communication of you, the geospatial people, and the BIM world. You cannot really separate it that much. But and think, for example, what is a product? If you talk with a civil engineer, a product is something that is delivered to the construction site, a window, a column. Yeah, that's a product. But in the geospatial standard, a product is always the digital delivery. So our product is digitally by itself, where in the BIM world, the product is something you can touch and additionally some digital information on about it. And that's really different. Or what is an object? The real estate manager says an object is the whole building. That's an object he's investing in. But for us as geospatial, an object is a polygon. Yeah, it's quite different scale. And we need to explain each other what is what we mean by the words. And we will write this dictionary in the next 2 years, maybe. And this was mainly the German contribution that we identified by our industry. So I was in the ISO group, but also had a German group with the German industry, not the whole industry, but like 10 interested engineers supporting me on the national level. And they said the most important thing is not to develop new standards, but to explain the existing standards to the other domain and to develop readable guidelines, how to apply, for example, georeferencing with IFC, how to deliver building models to a geospatial database. What are the restrictions for this? Do we need only boundary representation, for example? What's the coordinate system and everything? A GIS quality model is very important because BIM is very much more demanding on numerical accuracy. So the 3D engine of Revit is 10 times more accurate than the Oracle Spatial or PostGIS. So you're really on a other calculation, and it's 6 to 10 times more precise. And then the polygons are not really fitting. And this is a complex task. So to develop a GIS quality model that the GIS data are delivered precisely to the very high demanding BIM software. Then metadata. Both domains have metadata models, but how do we use, which kind of metadata are important for the BIM GIS export, and how is quality assured during the process of information delivery? Okay, this was the result of our working group. And interestingly, is this proper English? Interestingly, but very interesting, is that there was another working group, the others, yeah, that we don't like. And of course, we like them, and sometimes they are the same people in it. At the OGC and Building Smart pre-standardization organizations, there was a working group, OGC Building Smart Integrated Digital Build Environment. And they came to almost the same conclusions. This report is free. You can download it. It's only 18 pages, I think, so it's short. It's restricted to IC, CTGML, and land infra. So some really strong focus, but the result is almost the same. They say we need to define use cases so that the management level understands what BIM GIS integration means. We need best practice recommendations for three-dimensional georeferencing, vertical datum, coordinate reference systems, and all these concepts are not familiar in, are not used in BIM. We need to have a shared vocabulary. Yeah, we need to understand each other's, maybe the same way to identify objects with numbers. and an harmonization, whatever this is, of conceptual representations. So as a conclusion, BIM and GIS, again, some levels, you know, this is a complex topic. So I try to separate it in level. So BIM will give new opportunities for GIS business models. So the BIM is a method, and the BIM methodology is really good for us because we can earn more money, because the construction industry is more and more digital. So they need our data. That's important to understand. And we need to enforce the awareness of GIS. When I speak with civil engineers in projects with the German railway, with our local authorities, with construction companies, they are surprised that there are so many good, really important geodata. And it's important for us to go to the user and tell them that that GIS is there, that they need awareness. On the software is developing. You may have heard that Esri and Autodesk have a joint venture, and the software is getting better and better. It's still not really good, but don't bring this to the internet. In respect to georeferencing and geometric representations, it's not really good, actually. But in the future, the software will be integrated. GIS and BIM will be in the same software package. And data, this is one of our major tasks that we do right now. The data may be converted from one format to another. That's a good way, but it's not very, much the future. Intelligently merged or linked. And this was my last slide. And I hope I convinced you to download the technical report or read my paper. Thank you.
Has anyone has any questions? I would like to put it forward this very presentation on the climate resilience. I think two of it could be added to the problem of the problem. The problem is that all countries are staying on the ground. And the problem is when we are discussing about the geographical resistance, so they are focused mainly, thank you very much, they are focused mainly on the, how to say, the horizontal view and the upward view, yes? But I think that when you are talking about the geographical system and the BIM technologies and the dictionary about those two worlds, yes? So I think that it should be also focused on the ground, yes? The representation of the ground, because we are able, yes, within the GIS and the BIM technologies, measure for the centimeters or the millimeters, yes. But in the ground, we have, I think, very rare information in the comparison to the upward, yeah. And we are able only to interpret, yes, the quasi homogeneous bodies, yes, in the ground, yes, as various types of rocks or the rock masses. Yeah. And of course, we are able to only interpret this information from the boreholes, yes, or from some digging places, yes, or by geophysical measurements.
Yeah,
yes.
Very important.
But we have to put those information, yes, together to the one, yes, comprehensive model, yes, for the structure, and especially for the designing, yes, yeah. And of course for the operation, yes, because sometimes there are many problems, yes, for example, from the which are resulting from the groundwater flow and so on, yes, and the moisture content in the walls, yes, and it is the conclusion, yes,
of course.
Those worlds, yes, the ground and the up. Yeah?
Let me tell you two stories. One thing is in Germany we have working groups at buildings for building smart national level, and we provide the dictionary with words. And as one subgroup, the ground. So very important. You are totally right. And another story is, you know, I'm from Dresden and now I'm in Prague, and I took the train. And there will be a new train line from Dresden to Prague in the future. And this is currently planned. And I last week I had a telephone call with a lady from the ministry who's responsible for the, it will be a BIM project. And she said in her ministry, there is only one QGIS installation, a single person responsible for the underground of the largest building project in Germany when it will be started. So the German part and the tunnel, there will be 2,000 kilometer tunnel will be the largest tunnel in Germany. I don't know, maybe the second largest in Czech Republic, but it's a really huge project. And until now, at the ministry, is responsible for the underground, only one QGIS installation. So we need to provide them with some knowledge, definitely.
So, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
No. Yeah.
Can I start with my presentation? I'm sorry that I have a bad internet connection. I hope it will work. Can you hear me?
Yeah, Rainer, I'm hearing you.
Okay. So I start with my presentation. It is on bringing together navigation and BIM by the navigation status vector and by using devices which are able to catch the building and the environment. So, we are lucky in our university that we have both geomatics, geodesy, and also sensor system technology. So we can also develop hardware on navigation and on BIM georeferencing. So we have other projects which also use navigation sensors like geomonitoring. You see it here. And we have quite another project on gravity field determination. So we're also using gravity field, and we are knowing the georeferencing of BIM in respect to the gravity field as well. And but I will talk about navigation referencing. Do you understand me? I did not switch off the camera on the camera because of a very narrow channel. So we are working also on algorithms for GNSS. And so with this, I come to the main topic of today, namely navigation and the relation to BIM. You see that we are doing autonomous vehicle developments from hardware and from software. We are doing drone developments. We are doing also robots for catching buildings, like you see it here. And we are also very responsible for hardware development and software for this Volocopter, which is now a Daimler air vehicle. And so we are doing both navigation and georeferencing. And the last georeferencing is related to BIM. Do you understand my speech? I get no feedback, so but I hope that you understand me.
Yeah, we can yes. Hear you, understand you.
Super, super. Do you also see the slides?
Yeah, sure.
Yes. From a geodetic point of view, if you want to do navigation and georeferencing, very general, you have to use the navigation state vector, of course, also for georeferencing and for BIM. You will see this later. And if you want to determine the position, velocity, acceleration, orientation of an object, also the camera or the laser scanner, whatever, and the rotation rate and rotation rate changes, and you want to keep it most generally, then you have to go to a Markov chain. You say all my measurements, all my controls are events, and they determine the navigation state vector. And we'll use a laser. The navigation state vector density will depend will depend on all measurements, all controls, and the starting navigation state vector. And then you arrive at a Bayes estimation automatically. And this Bayes estimation then allows you to invert the finding of the navigation state vector by all measurements, by all controls of your robot or whatever you use, and the starting navigation state vector. This inversion leads then to the Gauss-Markov model of the sensor observations and some prior information on navigation state. When you want to integrate in this prior information part here, the preceding navigation state, because you can predict it, then you arrive at this so-called Chapman-Kolmogorov equation, and then you are complete with your approach. In case that your navigation state parts in this integral are normally distributed, then you will arrive by this equation at the classical maximum likelihood estimation, the classical Kármán filter, but this is also open for the particle filter. So in our group, we work most general on based on this central equation and either go to particle filter or we go to classical Kármán filter, but we modify it to a robust Kármán filter to avoid the influence of sensor observations. We handle generally distributed sensors, like you see it here, and so we are most general in the determination of the navigation state vector, which also helps for generating BIM modeling sensor boxes. So I'm not able in the short time to go to these observation equations for GNSS sensor and their lever arms, but you have to keep in mind that you have to use these lever arms, otherwise you are not able to model alone. You have to handle new data structures based on these lever arms, sensor on a platform, platform on a body. So this is described in this lecture, so to say, for all sensors, acceleration sensors, and relation to the sensor location, then to the body location. So new data structures are necessary for doing development on robots or drones or whatever, taking BIM models as well. I also will skip on this presentation ending in the Kármán filter only in case of normal distributed components in the sensor observation and in the prediction part. So now I come to the first project to catch buildings, to use buildings. This is MightSense. Here we are driving with a drone in these glass houses. We have to get the mites, small animals, small spiders, on the plants by a drone. We use all sensors which are available to fly indoors, MEMS, barometer, magnetometer, inclinometer, the IMU, of course. We do visual audiometry. We use a camera for getting the position information. And we even use a building to get the drone to fly along these plants and to find out the mites. So the picture, it looks like this. The drone is flying through this building, has no GNSS because we are indoors. So we have to develop our hardware. This is our hardware. We develop it also by ourselves because we have this sensor systems study program where I can take people to work on the hardware itself. We are working together with a German company, Multicopter, to get the drone, the next drone, for our sensor system. If you do georeferencing of buildings and then you use the navigation state vector and you have to have a very precise timestamp. The timestamp is doing all the job for the later georeferencing. Each image gets a timestamp. Your 3D model is constructed from different components with the exact timestamp. And so this timestamp is coming from all the sensors which are on the drone, hyperspectral camera to get the mites, a LiDAR. We compute all together in the Nivida Jetson TX2 computer on the drone. We have to develop a flight controller, which we also did before for this helicopter. We still use GNSS because our drone should also be able to fly outside. We take all MEMS sensors, inertial measurement sensors, and all other sensors which are typically for flights. And so we have a stereo camera, we have an Ethernet and Wi-Fi network on the drone, and barometer and inclinometer and magnetometer. So we use all position and orientation information sensors. So I hope it will now go on. At the moment, PowerPoint is stuck. I never had this. Ah, now it comes. If you are doing navigation, you have to determine this state vector. And here you see, if you want to use the sensors like a laser scanner or the camera, then you arrive at the SLAM, because your 3D map is then, as you see from the observation equations, is then on the right side occurring. So there is no way out. So you have the choice to use the sensor or the camera passively. Then you make a georeferencing of the laser point cloud by using the position and the navigation state vector and the lever arm of the laser scanner. Then you arrive at georeferencing equation. If you want to use a laser scanner or the camera, the optical components, actively in the, as an observation, then you have this equation, and you see there's no way out. On the right side, you get again the map, the 3D map in the Earth frame, if you want or not. Then you arrive at a big data problem, which is also connected to SLAM. We do both in our developments. We do georeferencing and SLAM. First instance, georeferencing, it's very easy, and SLAM is a little bit more complicated due to the mass data. So next slide should appear. I'm sorry, because this PowerPoint is not moving forward. Even if I click, if you know some advice, now it comes. So, and here you see this, what we are developing. The laser scanner takes the whole structure, also the building, as a 3D models, as a voxel model. So you have 3D small cubes in different solution. And then again, we have to reproject the image, which we is then detected by artificial intelligence. We have to reproject using again the navigation state vector back the information on the miles onto the 3D model. This is how we use a navigation state vector, which navigates the drone in the building, and at the same time is used to make a georeferencing of the laser scan and of the building. And the plants, and also uses the exterior orientation photogrammetric task of the image, of the classified image, to project it back onto the 3D model of the plants. This is our first project, and so just to see how we are working, how we bring navigation and building information together. We even wait again for PowerPoint to go forward.
Ryan, no rush. Take your time.
This happened. It is stupid. I sit in front of my computer and put a page down, and PowerPoint doesn't work forward. So this is impossible. I will shortly go out, but it is freezed. From the software technology point of view, it is freezed, the PowerPoint software. But I did not develop it. I don't know what I can do now, because I can even not go out of the presentation. I just have no idea. Does everybody have an idea how we can move forward in a PowerPoint presentation? Now it comes awfully. You see, we also use a BIM model itself. So we also have to take the model of the building, and then we have to fly with a building model by recognizing corners or features which have coordinates from the BIM. So our indoor drone has to navigate itself, not by using GNSS indoors, but by using the BIM model itself. And you see also, if you are knowing the building, we can also put here some conditions on the course by using the walls and using the ceiling and using the ground, by using Hesse normal form of these plans to put the drone onto a space where it can not be else, namely in this building. So this is also why we go from Kalman filter to simplex-based Kalman filtering and new algorithm schematics. So I will now come to this excavation machine where the report should be about it. Again, I have to wait for my PowerPoint. It is awful. Clicking and nothing happens. It is... So this is a cooperation, this HOBA, with a company who is professionally working on BIM in construction. This is MTS. You also find their link. They are doing a lot of developments in excavation. Excavation brought to BIM, and they even have training centers, and we are working together in this project with this company. You see what we have to do? We have to put a navigation box, which makes a georeferencing at the same time of this excavation ground onto the shovel of the excavation machine. So it will be put somewhere here. The box is under development, and the company will get it then to place it there. And we have two different approaches. The first one is to take the georeferencing of the excavation machine, which is already done, and use it to georeference a box by using the Denavid-Hardenberg equations to model all these joints. The second approach is to make the georeferencing in SLAM by a standalone box. So we developed two versions of such a box. The box is two computation computer. We can use the local machine server information, and we can make a lone standing box. We use here again all sensors, which I showed previously before. It's always the same. IMU. We also use GNSS here under very bad conditions, but we have this GNSS development developing robust algorithms for GNSS, and so we are also on GNSS here in this box, in opposite to the drone indoors, where we cannot use GNSS. But here we will use GNSS also as part of this box. Again, wait for the progress of this PowerPoint. I never had this thing before. It seems to be together with the presentation on internet that it is some codependency. I don't know why it doesn't work. Oh, it's still time. Clicks. I provided, of course, a PowerPoint presentation, and I provided the PDF of my presentation already, so it will not be lost in this way, but I would so much like to go on with the slides. So there seems to be some kind of witches here in this computer. Oh, I don't know what happens. I'm sorry. I cannot go on with the presentation because my computer is not working. So I show you here just what I want to show later. We use a time-of-flight camera. We don't use a laser scanner here. We use a time-of-flight camera to make the 3D model of the voxels. Again, we make voxels. And we use a RGB camera, a Triton camera, to make the classification of the soil. So we have the same situation on the drone, now on the excavation machine. we have to classify the soil by image processing, by artificial intelligence. This is done not on mites, but on soil. And then we have to project which is done, the 3D model, by a time-of-flight camera to project onto each voxel the soil content, and then we make a 3D voxel model which is BIM compliant of the digging of the digged out ground, so a 3D model of the excavation pit. So as I'm not able to continue here, so now it's definitively stuck. I just finish here because the principle has been shown already. Use the navigation state vector to georeference the box itself, and from there georeference each part which is needed further, like the laser scanner or like the time of flight camera and the images, and bring it back to the 3D model. I already also wanted to speak about the problem that we have to georeference the 3D model in this way, that it's concerning the geometry and the gravity field, because the direction is a vertical of the plumb line and not the ellipsoid. So we have to introduce the gravity field and the geoid here as well into the georeferencing of the pit. This is, I spoke about this mathematical problem and geophysical problem in the presentation in September 21 at the VDV seminar on BIM, georeferencing of BIM models. It is also included partly in this slides, but as I cannot go on due to Windows problems, I have to finish here. I thank you for your attention, and if you want to have this georeferencing slides as well, you can contact me and I will send them as well from this BIM congress in September, and these slides are also provided to the community by Karel Wach. He can upload it. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm very sorry that I first could not come as I intended to for personal reasons, and second, my computer is not working as it should. It is stuck. So thank you for your attention, and I wish a nice further congress. Bye.
Well, thank you.
Do of you course, hear I'm me? Open for. I'm open for the. I'm open for. Discussion.
We see your face.
Or questions.
I think we are not going to bother.
I'm open the camera questions. Now because. yes. Okay. It is clear because I didn't get finished, no? So I only made the start of the main part of the presentation. So thank you for your patience and for your understanding. I'm not guilty because my computer is not working with anymore with PowerPoint. So I'm very sorry. I never had this. I have to mind.
That's nothing.
Thank you.
Thank you for your solid presentation.
We're moving forward to the last presentation in this section. So it's not a secret that while we are here at our workshop in Far China, its capital, Beijing, the Olympic Games are being conducted. And so our last presenter is Professor Yaroslav Pollard, who will speak about the topic that is consonant with the Olympic Games subject. So the theme is designing white water slalom courses for Olympic Games. Please.
So, thank you. My presentation will be different from the others. Of course, all presentations are different, but this will be really different because it will show you the modeling and how the process of developing white water courses, and it will be shown on a white water course in Tokyo, which was for Olympic Games in 2020, actually 21. So what I want to show you here is I will introduce you into mathematical and physical modeling of water facilities. simulating and designing water facilities are different from designing other facilities. Of course, all facilities are different, but this is really different because in water facilities, we are simulating what is inside the water or air. But usually when you are designing, you are simulating, you know, the concrete or the construction itself. But here we are looking for the design of the construction based on the water flow. So that's why first we are designing the water flow, and then from this is coming the design of the construction itself. I will show it to you on based, as I said, based on whitewater course for the Olympic Games in Tokyo for 2020. Actually, it was held in 2021. Here you see the whole facility. I will explain you later. And here on this picture, you see how it works when it is under operation. We were responsible for all water, everything what belongs to water. So it's a reservoir lake, which is on the bottom. Pumping facilities, which is here, and of course, mainly for the whitewater course design, which is here, main course, and here are the special training loop. So let's go to a little bit science. I will not overload you like in a previous presentation. I will not overload you with lots of formulas, but I will want to explain you basic of modeling. We have two kinds in the water sector. We have two kinds of modeling. We have physical modeling, so we scale the facility, the construction. We scale it 1 to 10, 1 to 13, 1 to 15. And then we are modeling, trying to design the water flow, which is experimental analysis. And from as output, we have a pictures or some measured values such as velocities. We have second possibility, which is mathematical modeling. We can model it. The modeling we call CFD, computational fluid dynamics, and we are modeling the water which is flowing inside the facility and changing the shape or other behavior of the construction. We have graphical and numerical output. I will show you both of those modeling types. And from this, as engineers, we are looking for the safety and reliability of the facility. But we have also different view, especially for this kind of facility, is architect. We are engineers and we are looking from the bottom, from the bottom of the course, to the up, how it looks like, but architects are looking from the different view. They want to see it from the earth, and it looks nice, and it's perfect. So they have different view, and we have to find common language and common shape of this facility. The possibilities are very different from the guessing how it looks like through the direct calculation, which is not very efficient. But what we are using is mathematical and physical modeling, and especially combining of both techniques, which bring us the best results, because we can gain from both sides of modeling. if we are combining both models, we can do it with different approaches. We can use the same model for mathematical and physical modeling, and both combine into one. Or we can use as an input and output model of physical or mathematical model. I will show you both approaches on the end. The disadvantage and advantage of each approaches are that mathematical model, we can simulate it in one-to-one scale. But the physical model has to be scaled. So we have a scale distortion and some it has some uncertainties in this kind of approach. So let me go directly into this facility, which was built for Olympic Games, and introduce you how it looks like and what was our approach. As you see, everywhere is water. On the bottom, there is a reservoir lake, which has the what amount of water for pumping and using in this course where the competitions are or training is. So the water is fluctuating up and down, independent if it is under operation or not. Here has to be quite safe area because here is a pumping station, so we need to take care if somebody will, for example, swim or whatever will do. So there has to be low velocity, so it's a safe, let's say, kind of safe area. That's why here is this kind of band. And also, it has to, the pumps has to suck the water and pump it up. Here is the pumping station. There is four pumps, actually. Each pump can pump up to 4 cubic meters per second. And water flow in the course is, when it's under operation, it's 12 cubic meters per second. The reason for these four pumps is that if, for example, during the Olympic Games, in some failures happen, then we have one more extra extra pump. But also those pumps, when it's under operation, four pumps is under operation, so it's operating all, on a 75% of capacity. Here is the starting leg. So we developed the starting leg. I will show you in next picture. Starting leg where the water has to be calm. And also you see the pumps is pumping this way and the water is floating down this way. And here are the starting points where the water should be linear. So this was under development, how to deal with it. Also here, this black thing is the belt where the boats are transporting up to the start. And here the calm point for the competitors to wait before the competition. Then here is the course, and we've done quite a lot of modeling, physical modeling, to develop the water terrain. You see the blue boxes, which are the obstacles to create the water terrain, which has to be different and has to be difficult, has to be safe, and there's lots of points which we have to achieve to make it good and nice for the spectators, for the TV, and also difficult for the competitors. Here are the stands. It was built actually, even if it was not used, because as you might know, during the Olympic Games 2021, there was no spectators, so it was built even for no reason. So here's the spectators. Here on the middle part is the technical thing, such as judges, and the usually there is TVs and other technical equipment. Here on the bottom part should be the calm place where the competitors can get in and get out from the water. Also some stands and other facility. And here, this is the specialty, is a loop, training loop, which was created from jets, and it was the water was circulating around this island, which we called Honshu. This creates, let's say, training or warm up or cool down place for the competitors. So the reason for the jets was because this was built in earthquake area, and usually there is built a second less difficult course. But to save money, we choose this option to build this training loop, and then here again the lake. So this is how the facility looks like. Water is still pumped up and floating down, so it's very artificial course. So let's start with starting pool. On the left picture, you see the development of the starting pool, several design possibilities for the pump, if it will be from the bottom, from the side, and for the shape of the lake, the starting pool. And then here is the model, physical model built based on this mathematical model. So we achieved a linear starting point here, and all other things like linear those velocities, and here calm place in the middle. I already explained you how it looks. This is the reality, and this is the model which was built. I already showed you this starting pool, the development of the starting pool. Then here the main part is the course itself, which was built in our lab, and then we built also this training loop. I will explain and show you later. Now how it was built. This is a time-lapse video from the building, from the construction. On the bottom, we make some anchors, which will be visible almost right now. Yeah, you see the anchors. On the anchors, we put the ribbons and create the slope. The slope of the course is 2%, and it also has two steps. You can see one step here to create more difficult spots. Then we put on the bottom, steel plates because all the obstacles and other facilities were with magnets. This is our specialty. And with magnets, you can move to the obstacles and immediately you see the behavior of each changes. Yeah, this is the water test, and so we test the water if it is not leaking and not we don't have any problems in this course. Just by the way, for the evening we prepared for you a model. This was in scale 1 to 13, and our model is stayed just there. It's in scale 1 to 25, and on this you can test also the changes of the obstacles. It's also with magnets, so you can play with it. This was created for presentational purposes. Also, we will have for presentation augmented reality of a flow in this course. So in the evening during the party, you are invited to see that. So. The obstacles, in this case, it was cutted from the foam in a new design. We are using 3D printing for the obstacles, and we are placing it in the course. And there you can see the behavior of the water. First position is quite difficult. Usually there is about 1,000 obstacles. Obstacles has to be put. We have two kinds of obstacles. Actually, this is the starting valves, and so we have two kinds of obstacles. We have side obstacles, which we are putting always from the side, and the side obstacles are simulating or directing the water from side to side. And then we have bottom obstacles like this, which is creating the waves and stoppers and the water terrain itself. So when it is done, we are testing it with raft or canoes, just to see how the water flows and if it is safe. Mainly, we are measuring the water depth, which should be higher than 0.6 meters, or velocities, which has no prescription, but in upstream, it has to be lower than 1 meter per second. And this is the comparison between reality and the model. On the bottom, you see the model, and you see the velocity of the model. It has to be concluded because we are using similarity. I'm not sure. I don't want to go deeply to this. Similarity between reality and the model. For example, here we had the scale, as I said, 1 to 13. But the velocity has to be scaled 1 to 3.6. The reason is we are using the high-speed camera to catch the water flow. And here you see the comparison between the model, transition between the model and the reality. And you see the obstacles are exactly the same. Here is the reality, the model, and now you see the waves, 1, 2, 3, 4 waves, and in reality, 1, 2, 3, 4 waves. Yeah. So here, this is the bigger stopper, but this is on the bottom. So here is one stopper, one wave, and big stopper here. Yeah, one stopper here. Here is the wave and the stopper on the bottom. Again, the same. I was talking about the scaling. The scaling is very important in modeling, in a physical modeling, because without the scaling and using fruit similarity, we will not able to achieve the comparison between reality and the model. And last part, it was the simulation of bottom part, the lake mainly. We had the simulation of the lake, the whole lake, because the lake finished here and then it's pumped up. And the training loop. We had also comparison between mathematical model and the physical model. Here you see the comparison for the physical model we are using special language to write down the behavior of the water. Like here, you can see the stopper sign, wave sign. Here, we are using the direction of the flow upstreams, and also here is the visible the eddies between the stream and the upstream. Upstream is here usually where the upstream gates are. And here is the comparison between the reality, the CFD model and the mathematical model. We were done, as I said, the training loop. We were developing the position of the nozzles on the bottom here. Which creates the recirculating water to create the training loop. And here is the interaction with the main stream and the nozzles of the training loop. The development of this was, let's say, from the two-dimensional model, from 2D to 3D model. Actually, we received from the architects from Japan, we received the 2D model, how it looks like. Then we transfer it into 3D model because, the course needs to have slope. Without this, it will not flow. It was 2%. And then we developed all the facilities such as I show you starting pool, the main part, the bottom pool with the loop, and also the pump. I haven't showed you the pumping station. So we improved the 3D model. So it was sent it as a BIM construction to Japan. And each segment, as I said, it was simulated separately, combined with CFD simulation. Combined together, verified with the mathematical or physical model, and then it was written into BIM, into 3D model. But sometimes there can be some collisions. For example, the pumps cannot fit, or they have dig deeper, which happens to us. So we shift a little bit up the pumps, or something like this. So we return the loop again. And then it was returned into BIM. The difference between, as I said on the beginning, it will be different presentation because we are simulating what is inside, or mainly, for example, here, what is outside from the BIM, like where the water is flowing. So this is the difference between normal simulation of normal buildings and water structures, where we are exchanging not the construction itself, but the space which creates the construction. So that's how the exchange works. In some facilities, it's even more exchanges than in this case was. But I think this was quite presentable and quite nice example of development of such a facility. So thank you. You can enjoy how it looks in reality. First, I want to invite you in the evening. As I said, we will have presentation of augmented reality on a whitewater course. It is part of this course. And we have a mathematical model of the flow. I will explain you, I will show you, and lots of some 3D tricks. And also, last thing, I was asked to ask you: do not leave, because we will have we have to take pictures. So after this, we will meet somewhere, don't know exactly, outside, and take picture of all of us here. Of this people of the conference. So thank you. That's everything for me.
Well, Yaroslav, thank you again. So for this presentation, of course, we will get by without questions because you invited us to your laboratory where all of you can get acquainted with the results that just was presented. So our program for this section is used up. So I want to thank you, everyone who participated in our event. And now it's time for lunch.